威海维这是一个巨石妖港啊，它的这个正好是这个原来的北洋海军的一个军事基地，它对于中国的一个战略要地应该说是非常重要的。1898年英国为抗衡俄国侵占这个旅达，所以敲定要在驻扎威海。更重要的点是1899年在威海为曾经建立了一支雇佣军，那么他招募这支部队的时候已经感觉到了中国的北方人能干能吃苦啊，所以给他们种下了这个良好的印象。
走来走过来，俺那家穷的没法吃啊，穷的吃不上饭。干部我是穷光学罢了啊，还是穷的当啷当啷的了，吃不上饭，没有地图，就这点破房子没卖了，就包着老辈子也包着这点破房子，其他的啥也没有家，穷的当啷当啷的。当老辈子就是要，就叫着我挎着筐子要饭。
那穷啊，弟兄们多，都没找人，有的给房啥的，就像他有钱吧，我出去转那人家法国、英国的来，就像是说打个比方，楼上来雇人，他就去了。上俺奶奶那，咱我听说不让他去，又是上温州的，就上，他就硬去的了。就像挣两钱，那兄弟们那块生活是吧？
他为什么有游历欧洲的这梦想呢？原因是因为他有个哥哥哈，叫孙宝栋，啊，孙宝栋这哥哥曾经啊在清朝时候啊是个贡生，啊，在当贡生的时候，他曾被派过日本去考察明治维新，在那儿的时候呢，他回来以后，他就发生了很大的变化，他认为。我们国家要想真正的强盛起来，要向日本啊，就学习东洋明治维新，啊，改变自己的国家的面貌。他回来以后跟孙干先生呢就讲过这些事儿，所以孙干先生就立志要到欧洲去，考察西方的教育。
1917年1月1号，这个时候是天气最冷的时候，冰冻三尺。他们赶到了舟山火车站，所有报名的华工都在这个地方集合。最有意思的是，我连庄的唐武村王兆海的爷爷樱木华工，他的奶奶。抱着几个月的小孩，小脚插着小脚，哭着，一路哭着把他送到车站。
奶奶不让爷爷去，也鉴于我父亲太小，刚出世，但是父亲还是为了给家庭增加点经济收入，去了去英国。奶奶呢，当时就说了一句话，就说。不同意你去，你要去，那你去就别回来了。这句话又印证了。我们村去十一位去英国的，当时回来了10位，我爷爷就死在那儿了。
华工的赵母呢，他主要是靠吊水线的铁路两旁啊，赵母华工。主要的赵母地点呢，包括在西边的泰安、济南、淄博。潍坊、 家在青岛啊，这块儿。那么另外他依靠的是什么东西？就是交际线两旁的传教士，以传教士为这个组建的这些教母的网络，对外呢进行广泛的宣传，广泛的教母，通过交际线的这个铁路呢，他们由云岛为海为来。
There was a great movement to support China, to send missionaries there. My dad volunteered and went out because they needed people with Chinese, as they had, they were employing Chinese laborers to dig the trenches.
We found this whole stash of letters.
Yes.
In a very mysterious trunk that was left in Canada.
Yes.
And in there was one folder that was all letters from your father.
Yes.
To mostly to your mother. And there was a very nice picture of him as a dashing officer.
Yes. Very handsome.
Yeah.
My grandfather was Reverend Frederick O'Neill. He was a missionary of the Presbyterian Church of Ireland for 45 years in Manchuria. They decided they needed to have the help of British and French nationals who had some experience of dealing with Chinese, as well as Chinese people in America or Europe who were bilingual. So they summoned from China missionaries, doctors, people who had a knowledge of Chinese and knew how to deal with Chinese people. So that is how my grandfather was summoned to France.
My grandfather was an officer in the 8th Company of the CLC. He was called up in 1916. He was unfit for active service until the panic of early 1918, and he was shipped over to France. Well, when my grandfather first arrived, he had his Highland Light Infantry uniform on, and they had tartan trousers. The Chinese were fascinated by the fact that my grandfather had a different uniform from the other British officers. They liked the tartan. They also had trouble pronouncing his name, which was Morrison. The closest they got was Morris Dan.
My grandfather, William James Hawkins, was in the Chinese Labour Corps from 1917 to January 1920, when he finally returned to China. I understand he became involved in going up to Weihai Wei to look at the possibility of recruitment from the Shandong province, and he eventually, in early 1917, moved up there to be involved in the full recruitment, setting off in May 1917 for the first trip to France.
My grandfather was a doctor and surgeon who married into a missionary family, and he was based in Tsinan. He was known about by the consulate. In 1917, they realized that they were going to be needing doctors to help with the CLC. I have a photograph here of Niels Poulsen, who is employed as an agent to recruit CLC members near Tsinan. And there's also a photograph of Niels Poulsen with his son called Derek, and he was my godfather. And that is the connection between our two families.
This is 他这个照片呢是咱们第一次去到闸的时候，他是从周村招工局，但是这个负责人是姓蒲，他就是一个打麦人，他们的就是咱们海域姓就是说姓蒲，这是当时招工的时候称的时候，何英，他还有一张照片呢，是就是当时可能是回来之后，咱们呢给他送了一个石碑，对他们这挺满意。现在这一个呢就是导营
帝国大英国政府周村招工局总经理涂建、山东十五一等鞠躬。
今天咱们就是来这村里啊，看一看咱们当时参加一战的人呢，这里边有没有当时这个送的这个碑的这些人名。当时这村里去了12个，现在就是查一下。这位大爷，来来问哈，你是什么那个老本营出去的，叫什么名字？你说一下。
刘奎光，奎光啊。
啊，出去的是刘奎光哈，他是你的
爷爷，
是你的爷爷哈。这个
我是俺父亲，
他的父亲
叫刘同运
啊，刘同运。
你是？
我是俺大爷。
大爷和他是都是
叔伯弟
，你们的叔伯弟都是刘同运的后人哈。
我是我的老爷爷。
他是叫
刘登进、刘登英都是啊。
刘登进、刘登英。
那个刘登进，就是俺就是那个刘登进，也就是我的亲那个亲老爷爷。
一个亲爷爷哈。咱们找一下这个刘登进的名字哈，看一下啊，这个是刘登进，他这个跟这个刘登进，可能这个是进士的进。这个他两个字呢，有可能当时呢音译有点差别。
对，
刘登进，当时他们回来之后，
出去一样的叫你不得了。
回来之后呢，当时去给他送了一个碑，那个碑文上刻着有这个刘登进。我看还有一个刘发登是吧？你看一下那个刘发登。
还有邓英嘛？邓英是
刘登英，他这兄弟两个哈，都去参加的哈。
刘发登是吧？
I think what happened was that the recruitment was much more successful and quicker than they expected, and there weren't enough ships to carry away all the recruited labourers at the right time. So those that were waiting for ships to come and collect them went through quite a vigorous physical exercise period.
This is the 渭海的半月湾，对面呢就是一战华工营的遗址，大体方位呢就是东边。东边那个中间的这个拱形的这个屋顶，那么西面呢就是以这个屋顶为半球的那个建筑。一战华工营前面呢原来有一个码头，一个简易码头，就在这个底下的红色建筑的前面。在这个一战华工通过短期的训练之后，就通过这个简易的码头上了驳船，通过驳船再到停靠在前面的市市里面的大型运输船。
The sea passage across the Pacific was a major event. It was the first time that these Shandong farmers had been on the high seas, and there was a lot of
seasickness,
but also that there was a lot of, maybe because of how packed they were, there was some conflicts in between the people, and that so there was some trouble, according to this one Canadian missionary source. The Labour Corps was transported secretly through Canada for a number of reasons. One reason was simply strategic, and they didn't want the Germans to know about these things, because I guess there was U-boat activities on the Atlantic or what. So they stopped at these trains, which were sealed. They would stop at very rather out of the way places to rest and recoup, so, and not exposed to the general populace en route. So they were transported all the way to Halifax, which at that time took, I don't know, like 10 days or 2 weeks, and. When you think of moving over 100,000 people, that was a big logistic.
Across the whole of Canada.
Yeah.
My grandfather was a prolific photographer, and he brought his camera to France with the Chinese Labour Corps. And it was only recently, when I heard about the burials of Chinese in Folkestone, that I remembered that I'd just recently seen this box in one of my cupboards. You can see my grandfather had his name written on this box of slides, and it was here that I first noticed his note here of the Chinese Labour Corps. A typical contingent, for instance, at Bourbourg, he had maybe six or seven British officers. Then there were senior gangers who wore stripes on their arms, rather like sergeants, and there'd be eight senior gangers. There'd be then 16 junior gangers, and then hundreds of labourers underneath that. And the relationship, as I understood it, was that the British officers would get the orders, they would then in Chinese translate those orders over to the gangers, but then it was the gangers' job to make sure that the labourers actually carried the work out. Very often the British only spoke Mandarin, and there were many other dialects amongst the labourers, so the gangers would have covered all those different dialects in order to make sure that the orders were carried through.
Wo San Ye zhang de bi wo hai kui wu, ta yi mi ba duo, yi mi ba duo biao zhan de shan dong da han de xing xiang. Er xie dang shi zhe ge shuo ha, wei shenme zhe ge ying guo ren, fa guo ren lai wo men zhe ge shan dong zhe bing, dang shi jiu shuo wo men shan dong zhe ge jiao dong bing, dang shi shi zui hao de bing zhong, jiu bi zhe ge zhong guo chuan tong de zhe ge qin lao,
他要说会耍鸟和会武功啊，天天亏为也长的，呃，过了汉沟，来了周川缺银的，呃，也最有钱的了，有钱山地的后，呃，这先先和他别武啊，来走川走进去打擂台啊，没有打过他的，他得意啊，也就飞毛腿啊，他要，啊，他为何就飞毛腿啊？
They did a whole variety of operational works, from dock workers unloading guns, building roads, mending railway lines, and digging trenches, but also quite a lot of the photographs that Grandpa took were of them pulling armaments apart, and where the armaments couldn't be disentangled, then they would take them out onto the beaches and blow them up. So that was some of the work was quite dangerous.
The first job they did was to dig trenches for the British Army to retreat into. And the Chinese labourers knew how to dig a trench, but they didn't know how to fortify it. So the British officers decided the best thing to do was to get a squad of British soldiers to fortify a trench, and the Chinese would watch. So the Chinese watched the British soldiers do this, and my grandfather said that Mr. Wong, the interpreter, went over to discuss it with the Chinese, and they had a long confab, and he came back and he said, the Chinese would like to be set a task. In other words, they didn't want to have a time. They wanted to be, say, how many yards, how many hundreds of yards of trench could they fortify? And my grandfather said, much to the astonishment of the British officers, they'd done it by early afternoon, and were back in their camp drinking tea. And that's because my grandfather said they did everything quicker.
用一个木棍挑着两个筐，前面棍上一个炮弹，后面两个炮弹，这样他就晓得够了，这样他就说挣钱多。
他没擦脚扎斗啊，说的，没擦脚扎斗，他上娘，他当厨师。
那他当厨师，那么他原来在家里会做饭吗？
来家不会。
来讲不会呀。他说不，他回来了以后干了工，就接着做饭。他说我来外头学的，说做饭。
可是，在当时来说呢，我们的华工呢，大部分人都习惯于晚上吃的特别多，啊，一个是他时间比较富裕，比较充裕，他不再劳动了，哎，所以长期吃的就特别多。哎，可是英国人呢，他对这个饮食的管理啊是这样的，他晚上不让你吃的特别多，啊，他不是特意的不让你吃饱，他的英国的饮食习惯是什么？晚上几片面包，然后呢给你加火腿，加黄油，然后就当晚饭了，是吧？可这个量上来说呢，就差异很大了，所以华工们普遍觉得吃不饱。一吃不饱他就闹事儿，他认为英国人对我们华工待遇不公平，因为你当时的合同上写着管饱，你现在为嘛给这么少，怎么能管饱，是吧？后来为怎么解决这个问题呢，后来英国采取这个方法，反正伙食费给你们，自己做饭解决这个问题，你吃什么你自己随便，最后采取这样一方法，这是从那开始就是华工开始自己做饭了。嗯，
One incident, a French farmer complained bitterly to the British officers that his duck pond had been raided and all his ducks had gone. And he accused the Chinese labourers of doing it. So the British officers played dumb, because what happened was that their rations hadn't come through. And my grandfather said that he'd heard in other Labour Corps, if the rations didn't come through, they stopped work. Whereas the Chinese used their initiative to get hold of food so they could carry on working, which is exactly what the British officers wanted. And my grandfather said they got one of the ducks. So they're afraid the French farmer didn't get any satisfaction at all from the British officers.
Because my 因为他是当大队长，他是帮助管理化工的，他对这化工的情况最了解。我爷爷经常说，英国人、法国人对我们很好，主要是我们有些化工太坏，不听话，所以才引起了对他们的惩罚。你比如说鞭打，抓奸笔，有的还判刑。因为这化工他就说他都没管教，他都这英国监管也不听啊，中国这工头他也不听，他有些人很闹的就说，嗯。
这个文化上的差异呢，很多啊，比方说语言上的差异。这语言上的差异啊，他举个例子啊，就是说，比方说英语当中啊，有一个就是去，啊，到哪儿去，那个去啊 ，go， 咱们有时候在足球场上经常看到了 ，go go go， 就是去的意思。可是在中国哈，这 go 的发音呢，是指那个狗，是吧？英国人啊，在给他们布置工作以后哈，总爱说一个 go， 那意思走，一块儿跟我干活去，就这个意思。可是中国人一听是狗，管我们中国人叫狗，所以这华工呢就愤怒了。那个当时华工也是很有激情的，因为都是年轻人，他一听管我们华工人叫狗，所以就和英国人有冲突。
There were so many misunderstandings that arose because of translation difficulties. The British officers, the French officers didn't know what the Chinese were saying. Many disputes broke out. Some people were killed.
Where the Chinese laborers either misbehaved or refused orders, my understanding is that they were put in prison camps. The Chinese Labor Corps was operated under army rules, so they were very much under army orders, and so in those days, it was quite strict control, and I think that's where prisons began to come into operation, because the officers who saw people disobeying them would want to carry out some sort of punishment. I gather the punishments were just more hard labor.
My grandfather knew that if there had to be punishment meted out, there was a choice between having the labourer flogged or fined. So he went to the head ganger. He said, always flog, because though that was sounds very brutal, he said that the labourers were here to make money, and a flogging would mean nothing to them, and a fine would be money they would not get back. So when they were flogged, it was, I think my grandfather said it was 3 or 4 strokes across the back with a cane, and the labourer was tied to a post, and one of the gangers would administer this in front of the entire company, who mainly laughed because, they laughed at the stupidity of the man for being caught. And then as a final humiliation, cold tea leaves were poured over his head.
My grandfather's letter often say that they did very effective, quick work, but at times they were very laid back and probably not very happy with their conditions. And he was put on a panel of the martial court, and a senior officer was worried that that these martial law panels were stacked with a lot of very prejudiced people, and noted that my grandfather was a sympathetic person. So he thought that would be a good counterbalance. But he was very generally a very well disposed towards them. But there were passages where he felt that they were like children. But when I think back, they were very young. These people were like 18 or so, either 19, that they were actually teenagers, and they were mostly Shandong kind of peasant family people.
曾经遇到过这样的情况，有的个别的化工说你也给我写一封吧，他说行可以，他说我什么，那位化工说我什么也没有，他说我可以给你，书信纸，给你写，你说吧，你说了以后，我给你寄回去，说你叫什么名字，他叫什么名，你家是哪里啊，他说他不知道，你在什么地方住。 他说我也不知道，他具体的家是哪里，家中有谁，写信给谁，他都不知道。他只知道想写信给他家的父母，但是那种情况呢，就没办法写。所以说他也感到哈，在化工当中，不识字、没有文化的人，确确实实是非常吃力的，不光是。
Many of these Chinese students and intellectuals who were in Europe or North America and came to help the CLC, they played a very active role in this respect. And they remember were politically aware. They wanted to take this opportunity to enlighten these workers. So I think some of them did remarkable work in training them how to read and write and to understand European values, European customs. And I mean, some of these young people were quite revolutionary, or at least left-wing. And so they saw it as a good opportunity to further this. But I think the credit for this must go to these Chinese rather than the foreigners.
There was obviously lots of leisure time in between the 10 to 12 hours that they worked. And I think this one here of Chinese chess, I believe, was possibly also a route in which they used for very small gambling arrangements with their salaries, and that gambling was forbidden, but I gather it did actually take place sometimes more often than you would wish.
One of the jobs of the missionaries and the YMCA was to arrange entertainments for the workers. Now, they had very few holidays, but for Chinese traditional holidays, they could have the time off.
And I think for the workers, this was the happiest time.
They loved their flags and they put up flag days that celebrated the Chinese New Year.
战争方面呢，就是因为当时就是华工对欧洲战场他都不熟悉，甚至对飞机大炮都是第一次来演习，因为当时他们就根本没演习到这个方面的。那么另外的就是孙元学当时招募他们的时候说是承诺的是不到这个前方啊，而实际上他在瓦战壕也好，还有其他的这一些方面来讲的话，是在对敌方面的最前线啊，所以有很多华工就是献出了无辜的生命。
This was an industrial war. Now in China there have been many wars, but they were wars of a more primitive nature. But this was an industrial war, and Britain, France, Germany, they were the world's leading industrial powers, so they had the most advanced weapons in the world. So suddenly the workers were near this war, but they were completely unable to move. They were in these closed camps, they were not free. They could only leave the camps to go to their work, and then they were brought back again. So suddenly they were in this enclosed space, this war was going on close to them, and how could they have any comprehension of this war? So I think it was an extremely traumatic experience for them.
俺说有叫叔叔的，叫大爷的，说那飞机来天上不坐下来了，
这不是啥个？这灯不，他就踏着灯，说是抓抓悠悠的，说打着的，和大门口那么粗，说凉着的嘞，说啥个都看的，他们不嫌，他们不嫌，说还有那么凉的上班，说比北窑都清楚看的这燃烧的。
德国飞艇往下投了弹了，炸死人了，人们他就害怕了，有的都吓出神经病来了，都住了院了。当然也有少数的被飞机投弹炸死的。在战场上主要的并不是飞机投弹，主要的是互相炮击。这一战前线主要是双方的互相炮击，这样死伤人多。
They practiced acupuncture at each other,
using a needle stuck into a cork. So if they had aches and strains, they tended to do that rather than use Western medicine. Though one of the Chinese laborers was very badly injured when they were doing their battlefield clearance. A grenade exploded in his hand. He lost part of his hand and his stomach was ripped open. The British officers never expected to see him again, but 2 months later he was back and working, much to their astonishment. So that chimed in with their idea of how tough the laborers actually were.
就说他们去了以后吧，虽然是英，是华工。 但是后来都从军了，就是作为军人就上前线了也是。比方说是我祖父，一开始炊事员后勤吧，后来也是上前面帮着扫雷，最后是炮弹炸死的嘛。My
grandfather worked in a general hospital in Noyelle, on the estuary of the Somme. It was a general hospital run by the Royal Army Medical Corps. But it was also the base of the CLC, and there were mostly Chinese patients in this hospital. And he wrote a diary in the form of a poem, which describes daily life in the hospital. And I'll just read you a bit of it. By now, to take another rest, should I perchance incline, I must first walk around the hospital to see that no lights shine. Should I be disengaged and hear the welcome dinner bell, I to the mess will lift mine eyes for the food I've earned so well. But after dinner, back I come to the officer's duty room, ready to answer urgent calls for all those near their doom, and meet the convoys coming in at all hours of the night. To do this quick, it's best for me to only slumber light, in order that I may more promptly answer every call, for 'tis on me that all depends throughout this hospital.
The war ended in November 1918, but as you know, the job of the workers didn't finish because the French demanded that the land be returned to the condition that it was before the war started. And the land that had been fought over for 4 years, of course, was completely contaminated with bodies of dead humans, bodies of dead animals, shells exploded, unexploded, scrap metal, tanks, guns, and the French and the British and the Belgian people didn't want to do this work of clearing all this debris. So it fell to the Chinese and the other foreign workers to do this. So he left China in 1919, but the workers, they stayed, I think, till 1921 or 1922. My grandfather brought back a map showing the area that the 8th CLC worked in, southeast of Amiens. The area is marked in blue, and it had been where they were clearing battlefields. French authorities were worried, because this was agricultural land, that there'd be local starvation if the crops weren't put in by the spring of 1919. So they had to remove munitions, animal corpses and human corpses, for they destroyed the animal corpses. One of the stories my grandfather told me that I remember is a particularly horrible job the Chinese had to do. When the Germans retreated, they flung a dead horse down a well. So the Chinese had to go down on ropes to fish out the rotting carcass of this horse. My grandfather said that was a particularly horrible job that the Chinese managed to do.
He describes cleaning up after a battle, how they had to rummage through the field, picking up all the reclaimables, and didn't talk about bodies, but and it got dark and started to rain, and he said it was quite a nightmare taking his crew back in the dark, falling into these shell craters.
The Chinese Labour Corps were used for creating a lot of the British cemeteries, as well as their own cemetery in Noyelle, where originally they all got some lovely wooden crosses with their name on, but they have all been changed now for stone slabs.
He was asked in March 19 to return with several hundred CLC members on the hospital ship Neuralia. This is a log of his travelling from Noyelle back to Hong Kong. And it begins March the 17th, where they go from Noyelle by train down to Marseille. At Avignon, it states that number 92104 found wandering about at night, wanting to chow hai, which means jump into the water, and he was transferred to Mentals. At the end of the log, it says, since my last report, the following deaths have occurred. Coolie number 3945 TB lung. Number 36777 TB lung. And in fact, there are 10 people described in that way, and two jumped overboard and were lost.
这条呢一个故事比较印象比较深，他这个呢，他是这个化工的一个小头头吧，啊，也是军营这个营长，啊，所以他们退走以后啊，德国占领了，德国占领了，在他这个做饭的地方埋上炸弹了。 后来呢，德国退了，我们又去占领了地方，就开始在自己做饭的地方开始做饭，啊，才开始呢还不要紧，这个饭要做好了，有好多人围着吃饭，啊，他呢是一个，啊，就是这咱这个领导吧，没有带国人吃饭，啊，有那几个送到远处去，这个时候又炸他爆炸了。 这个事情对我印象最深，所以第一次沈大人结束他回国之前的时候啊，写了一篇纪念这些烈士的文章，啊，这上头有，进娄展小里捐躯者同胞儿，曰：吾后娄展死在雪兰半丘，抛五十头颅，争一万生命。
失地了，这次空前绝后之大战局。俺父亲正经的下，没了两处房子嘛，只留我知道是只留那么多地啊，只留那么多地啊。啊，他连先将军先领着一天下放一回下大洋来。 一天一回下大洋，所以俺上，俺爷这刷地主啊。
因为我父亲出去见世面了，觉得这没有文化不行，他本身没有文化。那时候，五几年就我上小学，从小学上了高校。这么六零年吧，我就上了直播年级中专。
所以说我很感谢我父亲，要不我没有今天。孙干，他这两次化工工程师是他自己的心血，他在收购的每批上开卷第一章就写上“开卷有益”四个字，这就充分证明了他自己对他自己这样的写作。 是非常非常的感到是应该的。他这里提到“工欲善其事，必先利其器”，所以说，轩辕氏我们的祖先，做舟车，有超市，公母为超，这都是我们的祖先利用工具而。
发展起来的。那么这种先进的工具今天呢还有，比方说他在战场上看到的飞机，这些飞机呢当时来说啊，哪个国家有飞机哪个国家就表示是非常的强大。英国、德国当时他们这些国家啊都是有飞机的国家，所以各个国家在战场上他的他们国家的武器的时候都有一种恐惧感。所以我们也应该学习用这种精神去创造我们自己的飞机，生产出更先进的武器，更先进的其他的任何东西都可以哈转化成我们国家的强大。
我父亲从法国回来，带了三样的东西，四样的东西来，一个是一条裤，一个是一双皮鞋，那就是一个杆子，还有一个盘盘啊，对对对，那些东西来的。
那么这条裤描述一下，这就是他在法国穿的。
他在法国穿的，来以后在家里要要穿几天，不就穿烂了，烂了就都撕不成裤子，就汤子绒的。那就是这下子呢，还有一个盘盘啊，那盘盘等俺这种的呢保存着。三年以后回来，等着三块现大洋。
走过来，奶奶。你说。这个就是我爷爷从法国带回来的那个纪念章。它上面还有个编号，我看这编号是多少哈？66131，131。这这就是说，咱的爷爷老爷这是个60000多号，这60000多号号，66131。
啊，那都是排着号，
排着号
啊。
咱这么说吧，凭这个号去嘛，你去领工资去。这话人谁那个我三姑，刚好你妈说的，他说咱这三年一分钱没领着嘛，咱不咱那钱上哪去了？没领着，一共从欧洲回来。挣了三块大洋
啊！
那是应该是每个月还有钱。
每个月，我听到奶奶说是每个月，捐好捐贴费也是发。
领了吗？没领着。
咱家
没领着，
没领。
俺奶奶太傻了，没领着。
就是。
一共俺爷带回来，没带回来3万块钱，3万呢，三个大洋，对吧？
不是还有双皮鞋？
还双皮鞋。
还有个这啥水的长，
还有个什么长色的那个
哎呀，我刚都赚10000钱了。
刚的真给拽了你，
要不用啊，咱天天滴溜咕噜滴溜咕噜。
当时我三爷回来的时候，有这个带回来的东西，有纪念章，包括他这个原来的那个衣服，也带回来了。就是他穿着当时那个衣服很自豪，因为在那个村里那个时候没见过那个东西，经常的像炫耀一样，喝上酒就穿上他那个衣服在那个村里转悠，哎，那时候觉得很威风，在老百姓面前。
My grandfather asked Mr. Wong what would happen to the laborers when they got home. Mr. Wong told him that the laborers would be big men in their villages if they didn't gamble it all away on the journey. But what they were really worried about was what Mr. Wong called the yellow men, by which he meant the Japanese, because I imagine they're all already very aware of the threat that Japan posed to China.
When I was in the middle of the year, I was 11 years old. I was in the middle of the year. I was in the middle of the year. I was in the middle of没我正好抽下了，你抽头肚子高着，就正好抽头多了，咱鼻子高着。俺这说，俺叫娘，俺不叫婆婆。俺娘啊，就叫缝到这布袋去了，专用布袋。走了，咱不都大件衣裳吗？大件衣裳吗？叫缝上了。那队伍走了以后呢？俺爷娘又俺拿去就嫁那一回，就嫁那一回，再也不嫁了。
回来以后也在村里办小学啊，一直到这个二辈辈子来了吧，他就是干了15年小学。 二位闺女来了以后啊，学校不办了，家里二位闺女来了以后，饭也吃不上了，所以他到周村呢，一个教会办的学校啊，那时闺女已经占领了，在那里教古典文学，教了二年，二位闺女投降以后就回来了。
这鬼子这时期俺哥哥不是去干的保路的，就这欧天的拿保路啊，拿保路教书啊，然后你俺又不让带教，去了带婆你就是上人家家里的水黑要教，最后呢是娘咱做啥吧，在真趁早找个村地上拿去，他住上几年再说，那不就上林子，林子老庄叫下庄，上路下庄，哎，那是一直住了八年，八年回来啥也没有了呀。都叫那个啥呢？广场一院子草的，啥没有了。那些东西都没了，也都碎了。那个都烧了，
When the peace talks occurred in Versailles, China had a place at the table, but the Allies paid no attention to China, did not give it anything of what it wanted, and in a political and diplomatic sense.The work and the sacrifice of the workers was for nothing.
我的大概是九十年代末回老家的时候，在我大爷家发现了这个勋章。我仔细看了看，这是英国乔治五世给我爷爷发了个勋章，而且呢，这个勋章的下面有一个号码，97237。通过这个档案号，就查询到。英国的军人墓葬委员会，这时候他们给我提供了我爷爷从英国去了法国，埋在一个法国一个军人墓里面。
我觉得是他们对这个战争的结束起到了一个非常重要的作用，因为当时就是我觉得这双方争夺的非常激烈，这个战争特别残酷很差，如果是没有这帮华工的参与的话，这个战争的胜负还很难说，而且这个战争什么时间结束这个也很难说，所以我觉得这批无论是中国也好还是英国法国美国等等这些参战的这些国家来讲的话，都应该肯定他们的贡献。那么在这190年的时候，我们都应该不要忘记他们。
You go to any British town or even any British village, and there are monuments to those who died in the First War and then the Second War. But this is completely absent in the case of the Chinese workers.So I think the first thing we must do is to create museums and monuments and public things which people can go to and inform them, so that people in Europe realize that in the First World War, which was a joint effort of many countries, the Chinese played their role in this war effort to defeat Germany, Austria and Turkey.
因为我们，你看我是第三代了，我都50多岁了，有都60多岁了，都不年轻了。因为这个事儿要是做不好，往下就根本就给断层了呀，就没有人再什么了。
呜呼，欧战四载血染半球，跑无数头颅，致亿万性命。使得了结此空前绝后之一大战局，生者有何能，君留欧西，我还亚东，悲愤交集，感慨激情，同声一哭，泪洒襟胸，悠悠捆捆，电耳之灵，呜呼哀哉，上想。